We are ready to get going. So, Ken, we'll turn the time over to you and good luck.
All right. Good. Thank you, Allison. Yeah, this is Ken Davis. I'm a consultant with ProModel, been with ProModel for quite a while. And I live down in North Carolina. Been working with a lot of different companies, including some that are on this meeting as well. Work with all types of industries, all types of models. And Jennifer, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. I'm Jennifer Cowden. I am Director of Consulting Services. I moved into that role about 6 months ago. For 8 years previously, I was a senior consultant and project manager as well here with ProModel. Thanks, Ken.
You bet. Now, everybody that's listening here, notice that there is a question panel, I guess you'd call it, inside the GoToMeeting window. So if you have any sort of question at all, please type it in there. I'll be looking at it, but both Jennifer and Austin will be looking at it a little bit more carefully. And we will pause with any answers as appropriate whenever the question is raised. We'll also have a Q&A at the very end, of course. And I expect that this will take something less than 45 minutes. It'll be more than a half hour, less than an hour. So that's the expectation. All right. So to get into it, this webinar is talking about subroutines and macros. Now, I assume that all of you have used ProModel. I'm pretty confident of that. So you know what subroutines and macros are, but there are some aspects of each that you may not be aware of, and that's why we're doing this advanced session, because there are some rarely used aspects, particularly with macros, that can be very helpful depending on what your requirements are. And this will be pertaining to ProModel and MedModel, as is almost always the case between those two applications. There is a little bit that might be appropriate for Process Simulator, but we are not going to approach that at all. So this is not for Process Simulator. It's only for ProModel and the MedModel. And what is my key? There we go. All right. So the purpose is these particular points. Why would you use a macro or a subroutine, particularly one over the other, because there are some couple of reasons that you could use either. What types of macros are there? There are six. What types of subroutines are there? There are four. And there are different ways to use subroutines as well. This is not a tutorial of basic logic statements for neither macros nor subroutines. So as I said before, we assume that you have some knowledge of how to model in ProModel and MedModel. Here are the topics, and here are the six types of macros that we're talking about. I'm sure that you've used scenario parameters, certainly logic statements. I'm not confident that you've used these others. So as always, we apologize if we're telling you something that you already know, but we're hoping that we are enlightening on new material. I hope that's the case. We'll find out. Then subroutines, there are four types, actually. I'm grouping these two together, integer and real. And then also with subroutines, there's two different ways to run subroutines, and some real critical aspects of that we certainly need to know about. So what should we use? Well, first of all, it depends on what you want to do. The functionality of each is quite varied. Let me go back up here and notice that subroutines can be logic statements. Macros can be logic statements. So that's why this second bullet is here. It might be just a personal programming preference. Some of us like to put all of our repeatable ProModel statements into macros, and some of us like to put them in subroutines. So that's really a personal preference. But there are times when one is only good and the other is not functional. So why would you use either a subroutine or a macro? If you have lines of logic that will be executed in multiple places, really any logic window that you want to change the logic just in one place and therefore not have to go to different operation logics and windows and change. Just one place is the key thing there. So therefore, either is okay if that's the only reason you're using subroutine or macros. However, macros are the only thing that you use for scenario parameters, putting into the scenario manager. There's also this thing called text substitution, aka constant values. We use them quite a bit. We'll exhibit that. It makes the modeling and input of data much more powerful than just dealing with numbers. Then there are resource groups, and that can be used in two different ways. I'll show you. And these are the two that most folks don't know about: arrival schedule records and shift schedule records. They are very useful for creating different scenarios. They're both kind of tricky, however. I'll show you what to be aware of and as far as the trickiness. Okay, a subroutine can only be used, I should say only instead of a macro, if you want to pass a parameter into the logic. I'm taking you back quite a way, whoever runs Fortran now, but I'm just picking any language. A classic subroutine in any language usually has some parameters that you pass to it. And subroutines in ProModel and MedModel allow you to do that. There's a big however. If you just use attributes on entities within a subroutine, as soon as the subroutine is finished, the entity that executes the subroutine already now knows what the value of the attributes are, and therefore there's no information needs to be passed. The attributes of the entity as you execute the subroutine means that the logic in the subroutine already knows the value of all the attributes for the entity that executes it. Therefore, you might say legitimately, I don't need to pass any parameter to the subroutine. There are reasons you might want to. One is it is more obvious if you pass a parameter to the subroutine as you're building the model and running it. It sort of focuses your thought on what it is you're passing to the subroutine. And also, it may be that it's something that is not related to an entity. Therefore, there is no attribute. I'll give you an example of that. Another reason you would want to use a subroutine and not a macro is this interactive aspect. An interactive subroutine is one that you can execute, or I guess it's called activate. Interactive. Now you execute interactive subroutine. Critical thing is it's during the simulation run. So you can hit a button. It'll pause the model, allow you to change something, and then carry on. So it's an ad hoc modification to the model during the run. We would be very difficult to perfectly repeat that ad hoc interactiveness. Therefore, I wouldn't consider it a real good analysis technique. However, it is a good sandbox and academic what if type exercise. We'll show you how that works. Now, here's a little nugget. Used to be galaxy far, far away. Well, really just back when computers are not as good as they are now. It used to be that models ran faster if you used a macro rather than the subroutine. That may still be the case, but now it's no big deal because computers are so powerful and fast. It just really doesn't matter. So that run speed should not should not
I've
be
heard
a
it's the
concern.
opposite now.
It's the opposite now.
Yeah, that's what I've heard, is that subroutines are now faster. I don't know
Now
how the inner workings are, but that was what I've heard.
Okay. But would you agree, Jennifer, it's probably not significantly noticeable?
Probably not. Yeah, I don't know that you would ever notice, actually.
Right. So it may be the case. And things change with the engine over the years, so that might have flipped. But in my opinion, it's no big deal. All right, how do you build a macro? Well, you probably already know how, the macro edit table. And how do you build a subroutine? You probably already know that, the edit table in a subroutine. And both, of course, have the logic window where you put in logic if that's appropriate. If it's just a initial text is the logic. There's the text over there. It might just be an initial value for a parameter if it's a macro. Okay, first type of the six macros is a scenario parameter. What do you do between scenarios? And I'm going to guess this is not new to anybody, so I'm not going to dwell on how to do that. But that is certainly one reason that you would want to use a macro instead of anything else to be able to control your parameters, animation speed, really anything. And of course, when we create the scenario parameter with the options, or we right click right in that area, we have the choice of either unrestricted text, record range, or numeric range. Most folks, I suspect, have used the first and last. The record range, usually, I mention that to folks, and they haven't seen it, so we're going to show how that works. Just a reminder, unrestricted text, it could be anything. So you could misspell something. When you go to run the model, it won't be spelled correctly. Leave out an underscore or something. But the parameter itself doesn't care. Numeric range, of course, you can specify only certain values to be valid. All right. The next macro type is text substitutions, aka constant values. Now, we use them, this type of macro, quite a bit. It allows you to use real words rather than just numbers. Remember that everything in the simulation model, in a simulation engine, really gets translated to numerics. Like if you name an entity, it doesn't really use the word of that entity. It uses the index number in the entity table for that entity. Therefore, we like to use words like the entity name. I like to use the word yes and no rather than zero and one, or one and zero. That, of course, is binary. But what if the choices were not yes and no? Maybe it's red, white, and blue, where you could assign numbers to them. One is red, two is white, and blue is three. But why even try to remember that? Just put in red, white, and blue over in the macro table. Just list it right here. And then within the context of that list, that's a key thing, within the context of a list, just number them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, however many. So what I have here shown on this slide is there is some macros to control a subroutine, which I'm showing over here. I'm going to execute this and exemplify a little bit later today. But here are the choices. Enter, leave, use resource, move with the resource, enter, no, leave, and no. And there's numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then we can use the words in our logic rather than those numbers, and it makes the modeling a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
And then here's the example of using the yes.
Yeah, I use these for column headers in arrays all the time, because when you're first starting out with your model, you've got all these input spreadsheets and you don't know if your columns are going to grow or not. So I usually start off naming my columns, and then it's a lot more readable in the code. And it's a lot easier to verify that you're referring to the correct column index in your array if you've got the name of what it should be there in the code. And that way, if it changes, you can just change it one place in this macro table and that updates it everywhere.
Agreed. Now, let's see if I'm going to, we've got one more slide on this. And I'm going to show you a good example of how this is used. So this is great. Anywhere there's a list of stuff, I'm not being real specific because it's really anything that you have, anywhere that you have a list of things that are not standard elements like entities, locations, resources, this is a great implementation, such as part numbers, truck route destinations. That could be a list of cities. However, you got to remember that the standard per model naming must be done. So if you've got a group of part numbers and they're all numeric, you cannot put the numbers in as the name of the macro. You need to append a legitimate piece of text in front of, and I usually just put PN underscore and then whatever the numbers are. You know, if you're looking at your standard processing and your shop management system, you may have thousands of different part numbers. Just list them in Excel. Use concatenate to put something like PN for part number underscore in front of all of them, and then you can copy paste them using ProductiveX. And as all of the macros in your model, so quick and easy, you can put thousands of part numbers into your model really quickly. Also, you got to make sure that you don't use any reserved words. Like, notice in my example here, I said enter and leave. Well, I didn't say enter and exit because exit is a reserved word. I can't use that. So I just use the word leave instead. Let me show you a real example. I'm going to bring up this model. and we have a list of, in this case, grades of paper at a paper mill. And we use the numbers that were given, put the word grade in front of it, and just number them 1 through 11. That's a small list. I've had models with lots of other longer lists, but that's how you do it. You just list whatever it is, make sure that they are contiguous, and number them 1 through N. And it doesn't matter. Well, actually, they don't have to be starting at 1. It's just any number, as long as within that list of stuff, each one of these has a unique number. And then when you read them in from an Excel expression array, reading in a production schedule, for example, you can bring in the name of the part number using the macro. And I'm just checking, any questions on any of that? No. And Austin, is there a way, in case somebody must speak, for them to raise a hand? That capability exists, doesn't it? Or I guess put that into the chat.
Mm-hmm. That's right. We do have the chat here available for the entire audience and also the questions menu. And we're able to see both of them from our view. So we'll see if anybody has that. We'll see it.
Okay, so unless we see something like that, I'm going to assume that there are no current questions, so I'm just going to carry on. Okay, macros with just logic statements, just like a subroutine, you can put any sort of logic in a macro. In fact, some of the folks in our consulting group prefer to use macros instead of subroutines, and some don't. Some like to use some of these instead of macros. So that's the personal preference. However, there's no limit. There's no constraint on which statements can be put into a macro. The constraint would be how you use it and where it's used. For example, a presentation script. That's just a real simple, good example. And in fact, I've got a demonstration model here. We've got right here, I've got macro called initialization. As that is run from the general information initialization logic, see? So we don't have to put all the logic in this little initialization logic window. What we like to do instead is either name a macro called initialization logic, or, and I believe this is the case in the other model, yeah, subroutine initialization. So in this case, both the macro and the subroutine, we pull out the logic for the initialization outside of that general information window. It's harder to get to, and I think it's less convenient to put it there. And then we can execute either the macro or the subroutine initialization at the beginning of the model from the general information.
I wanted to point out a caveat with using things like expressions and stuff for your macro. So a macro does not compartmentalize your logic like a subroutine does. So let's say, for example, you had a macro, let's say you called it this macro name, and you had several terms that you were adding together because you wanted to add them together several times and evaluate them several times over the course of your model. Be aware, what ProModel does is whenever it sees the name of that macro, it takes the logic or the text in that text field and pastes it there where the macro name is, and then it performs any order of operation logic. So if you had something that said, okay, two times this macro name, it's going to put in that list of terms that you're adding together, and the two is only going to multiply multiply across the first term, unless you've remembered to put parentheses on there. If you do have some terms that you want to add together as part of a macro, make sure you put a parentheses either in the text itself or around the macro name. Believe me when I tell you, it can take a really long time to debug that.
Thanks, Ken. Yeah, a good trip. You can trip over that easily. Agreed. Okay, the next macro type is a resource group. And by the way, I didn't say this before, but let me just point out. Let me clear this. Notice there is nothing here that says type of macro. Unlike subroutines, it's very, very obvious. There's your types of subroutines. Macros, it doesn't say that. It sort of infers it if you come over here to look at the construction window, because resource group, which I'm getting ready to talk about, is one of the options. Or if you go into scenario parameter, define, there are a couple of the different ways. So just wanted to point that out. There's nowhere to list macro types. Okay, this next type, very helpful. Resource group allows you to easily list multiple resources of choice for particularly a get or a use statement. And also the ands and ors with parentheses are very helpful. Therefore, you can, instead of in your logic specifically saying get clerk or supervisor, you can move that over to a macro, give it a name, and then put the choice, including ands and ors and quantities and whatever, parentheses, in there. And then you can say get m crew elsewhere in your model. So I've got that example here. Let's say that's the ID itself. So right here, we get the crew. And if we decide to change our mind and switch it from clerk or supervisor to supervisor or clerk, and that combination is used multiple times in the model, then you only have to change it one place. If you decide that you want to add something like a material handler or any other resource to this list, it's easy because you put it in one place, and then therefore, wherever in your model, I've only got it one place in this model, just for demonstration purposes. Anywhere in your model, it will be executed. By the way, this model may look familiar to you. It is the receiving demo model that comes with ProModel. It was created by a fellow that I knew in Atlanta some years ago. All right. So that's one way to use the group, but there's also another really good reason to use group is for aggregate reporting. Because notice this next macro, it says all resources, clerk and supervisor and fork, and that's what is in this model here. So we never, in our logic, we never either get or use all resources. But just the fact that we've named that and created a resource group, which is done by simply doing a check right here. See, that went away. I would do a right click and then a left click, and that turns it into a resource group. So then when we run the model, this model runs for about a week, but I'm going to halt it and look at statistics. And so the benefit of this resource group is that notice that it lists the utilization of all resources, which looks like it's about 82% in use and 4% travel, even though we never asked to get all resources. So it's really handy because you can name every type of resource in a work cell, even though you never acquire them all together. And then you get the aggregate, essentially average, including quantity of all of the resources that are specified in that group. So very, very handy feature for reporting purposes. And it treats it just like any other resource in terms of utilization, state graphs, things like that. Okay, moving on. Well, there's a picture of the what I just showed you. So all resources, crew. And notice that each individual is shown, then the group is shown, and then the group is shown. All right, the next type of macro and the one after are pretty similar. And these are scenario parameters, and I've got three arrival records here, three arrival scenario macros here, and then four shift scenario macros. And the way you get to them is you define a parameter and then select it as a record range of type arrival. And I'm going to explain what these numbers are here in a minute. This one down here, if you do the same thing, you'll see that it is defined as a record range. Oops, didn't dwell there long enough. There we go. Yep, shifts. So there's a record range of type shifts. So So let's explain a little bit about these things. If in the scenario manager you wish to specify which arrival records to run, and everything on this page is going to be essentially duplicated on the next page, using scenario manager to specify which shift assignment records to run. What you do is within a list of arrival records, you say, which one do we want to use? Now, a list. In this demonstration model, we go over to arrivals, and here are arrivals for the semi-truck, the small truck, and the work for the supervisor. And notice that for each of those, we have two different arrival records. Now, the only difference between the two is just the quantity. In this case, we're multiplying by one. In this case, we're multiplying by two. We're not trying to use this as an analysis. I just wanted to point out that those two arrivals are different. Now, this is arrival record number one, and this is arrival record number two. So that's what we mean by records. This is number six. So within a group of arrival records, in this case, between one and two, we need to decide, do we want to use number one or number two? Between numbers three and four, do we want to use three or four? And the same thing for between five and six. So that's how you describe this. Specify the default in the text field for the macro. Let's look and see what that looks like. So if we go to the definition of the macros for this arrival, for this one, for the semi, we called it M arrivals semi, and that word arrival gets appended automatically. If you define as an arrival record scenario parameter, it will automatically put the arrival word there. You can't get rid of it, don't want to get rid of it, and you don't have to type it in because it happens automatically. So between records one and two, so here it is, between records one and two, we want to use number one. Between numbers three and four, we want to use number three. So that's what we mean. Within a list, which one do you want to use? Same thing down here, between five and six, we want to use number five. So that's what it means, specify the default. And right here, this is what I meant by the arrival. The term arrival is automatically added at the beginning of the macro name. Now, this is where it gets kind of tricky, because if you just simulate, then it will, I need to get to arrivals. If you just simulate, it will look at this disable column over here to know which ones to implement. So there's a difference between simulate and simulate scenarios, or use the scenario manager. If you just simulate, the pro model will use whichever ones are not disabled. So to implement what I just described with just a simulate, we need to disable 2, 4, and 6. If we wanted not to do that, if we wanted to, use 2, 4, and 6 and not 1, 2, and 3, we need to disable the ones that we do not want to execute. Now, I've put some logic in this, these arrivals, and you'll see there's a down here in the bottom. So right now, I've disabled 1, 3, and 5. So if I run the model, notice that all of the arrivals are taken from the arrival 2 schedule. If I don't want to do that, if I want to do it, just flip them all. Now it's 1, 3, and 5. See? Now the arrival ones are used. So that is a possible way to implement alternative arrivals. However, the macros, if they're defined as record range macros, see, I can create a scenario that says use 1, 3, and 5. Let's do another scenario that says use 2, 4, and 6. And I can try to run the scenarios. Let me say okay to that, but let me demonstrate one of the tricky aspects of it. All right, we have the first arrival disabled. So now if I try to run these two scenarios, wait a minute, did I do what I wanted to do? Yeah, one is being run, but yet one is, that fools me. Jennifer, I thought that if it was disabled, it could not execute the arrival. Oh.
I know with shifts, it's different.
Yeah, it did not. Yeah, okay. It threw me for a moment. Let me run that again. It did not run them. See, if I go and I want to run those two scenarios, notice there's nothing coming in. That scenario one ran, but there were no arrivals because the arrival record was disabled. I did not recognize it at first because I'm remembering the you'll see in a minute about the shift records, you will get an actual error. But that wasn't an error. It just ran through that scenario so quickly because there's nothing coming in. Jennifer, did you have a comment there?
No, just pointing out that they're different, and I don't know why. It seems like they would have picked one way to do it and they've been consistent.
Yeah.
It is different with shifts.
All right. So if you would like to use the scenario manager to manage your arrival records, you really need to have all of these enabled. Now, if I run these scenarios, you'll see that it does execute because that arrival record is not disabled. So that's what arrival records are all about. The shift records are very similar. Everything I said about arrival records is true as well, except I added this little thought here. But trying to figure out which scenarios, which shift assignment records are implemented if they are disabled, can be very confusing. Let me say it another way. If you run with just simulate and all records, shift records are enabled, then it can be very confusing because overlapping shift specifications can play havoc with how you are observing outlines. So here are shift schedules. So for the clerk, and the clerk in this model is made a little bit bigger. It's this guy down here. The fork and the supervisor are a little smaller, but we're picking on the clerk. So we have two different schedules for the clerk. So if we bring that up, not much different. We've got three breaks for Schedule A and then for Schedule B. And by the way, the clerk is using the fork truck schedule. That's okay. But the B schedule only has one break, so we've got a little bit more working time. But at least they are different. And if we do not disable, then in our scenario manager, let's uncheck those two. And we're going to run 1, 3, 5, and 7 for shifts 1, and then 2, 4, 6, and 8 for shift 2. We're also enabling through another macro, a yes, no macro, that we want to execute this shift logic, which is displaying which schedule one or two is being implemented during a particular run. So what we're going to see is there, the clerk went on break. So the clerk is standing over by the Coke machine, and schedule one made that happen. Those were running shifts one scenario. Now shifts one has three breaks. So there's the second break, and there's the third break. And then they're going to go off shift down to home. So went off shift with schedule one. All right, so I'm going to just say yes to all of these okays. This run model runs through Friday. I could halt it, but let me just let it run. Notice that all of them say from schedule one. Because when we get to shifts two scenario, that will change to note that schedule two is implementing it. All right, so now we're running shifts two. Clerk went on break with schedule two at 9 something in the morning, 8:38. And then there won't be another break during the day. He'll go home. There you go. He went off shift because the second schedule was implemented. And the same thing will happen the next day. He'll go on break one time, work all day, and go home. Now, let's say that we wanted to just simulate and not simulate scenarios. Just like before, we would have to choose which of these to disable. So let's say we wanted to run 2, 4, 6, and 8. That would work, because we've disabled the ones that we did not want. However, if we try to simulate just scenario, well, I'll do both of them. We run scenarios wait a minute. Disable, yes. That should have been just one.
Yeah, that usually enables it when you put it in the scenario manager. Yes, I thought it did.
Yeah, it overrides. No, notice. I hope everybody is recognizing that this is kind of tricky. See, we still have display those shift patterns on, but notice those displays are not happening. Therefore, the shift schedule, even though it's specified in the scenario manager, is disabled. Therefore, it's not invoked. So what I would want to do.
Yeah, I swear I've run that before, and that I got a different result. That's interesting.
So let's run that scenario. And now, see, it is invoking that shift schedule because that shift schedule is not disabled. And then he'll go on break. Okay, he's got three breaks, shift schedule one.
Like,
all right, so yeah. What was that, Jennifer?
I was just saying, definitely something you want to experiment with to make sure it works as you think.
It is tricky. This is extremely powerful. I've got a model that I'm working on with some folks in Richmond, and they have dozens of different schedules for a material handling depot. And to have to go into macros and disable, enable, disable, and that's just, you can't spend that time. But this feature of shift assignment records works perfectly as long as we design it correctly. Okay, let's move on. We got a little bit more to cover. It's going to take more than 45 minutes, but it'll be less than an hour. Okay, subroutine type of none. That's just an executed subroutine or activated subroutine like we are used to. I could show an example, but I'm going to move on because that's something that I think we all know about anybody. Anyway. All right, the next type is the integer or real subroutine. And, of course, that is specified when you name the subroutine, give it a type, integer or real. And what that means is that the logic of the subroutine must have the word return in it. If it doesn't have return, it won't work. You can have multiple returns based on the if-then logic. But a good example is, say you've got a bunch of complicated logic to determine whether something either passes or fails at a workstation. It might depend on the model number, the operator doing the work, which machine you choose to do it on. Could be a lot of different reasons. And what you want to do is return a single number like a 0.02 for a 2% failure rate. So that's a good, really good reason to create a real subroutine. Then, there's a however. You could just assign an entity attribute for the desired value. Just like before, an earlier slide, that's true. It's just that sometimes creating a return subroutine feels better. You've kind of focused on the logic in just one place. However, you could use an assignment of an entity. Therefore, after the subroutine finishes, the entity attribute knows the value, and you don't necessarily return a number. But sometimes you might need to use a real or integer subroutine. I'll give you a good example here. If it's a non-entity related item, you can't use an attribute. So I've got a model here where the input file is quite large. If I zoom out, you see there's a lot of information there. This is all read into an array, and certainly we have the rows for the array, but what we also have here is a unique identifier called an item number. So if I want to know, for example, how many yard trucks there are in the system, I would look up with a subroutine, find me the number 1 in column H, and return that number. If I want to know how many truck drivers there are, look in this column and find the number 336. I now know that that is the row of interest, and now I know from what scenario we want to run what is the value to pull from the array. And that is exemplified in this subroutine here. So it's a do loop. It goes through every row in the array called scenario data. We pass to it a parameter, which is the item number of interest, in my example, 336. And then we go through there and say, if the item in the row of interest, which is column 1, which is column H, equals the parameter of interest, that's my guy. Therefore, I say return the row, and then in our processing, let me see if I can properly find 11, 12, I think. Yeah, here's a good example. I'm looking for item number 39, so that is the row drawn from that subroutine. The column is my scenario number, and that is put into a local variable. So that was an array where the row number was specified by simply naming the subroutine. And the reason is that it had a return statement in it. So that's my example. Okay, moving on. Interactive subroutine. This is seldom used, but I wanted to describe what its purpose is. I'm thinking experiments and what ifs. The reason is it's totally ad hoc, and therefore you can't repeat when you call the subroutine. Let's go back to our demo model here. We've got a subroutine here called interactive type right there. And it has a prompt statement, which is going to pull a new variable value of a factor. And here's just what it looks like. In our processing logic, we say wait some amount of time based on however many items there are in the load, throw a distribution in there. But then we also throw a factor in with a default value of 1. And then we can run that interactive subroutine and change the value of that parameter on the fly. Let's just run that scenario. So that's this factor right here. So that is sort of the default situation. But if I come up here to interactive subroutines, this panel pops up. Notice the model is paused. We can either double click on the name and we can have multiple interactive subroutines. We only have one here. Or we say activate. Then whatever text we have designed into that subroutine gets displayed here. Specifically, it says enter the desired traffic desk paperwork processing factor. Its value is 1 right now. What if we made it 0? In other words, we made that process totally automated and unnecessary. And we may see a change in the number of trucks waiting to be processed correspondingly. Let's change this and activate it again. And instead of 1, let's make it absurd. Let's make it 100. And I think you'll start see trucks starting to gather because the traffic department just can't handle the load. It's taking 100 times more than you thought necessary. And therefore, that's why I claim that this is good for experiments, what is, academic exercises, et cetera. And Jennifer, I think you used this successfully on a particular model. I think it drove you to a better solution quicker. Is that right?
Yes. It was a model that locked up frequently because it was kind of a continuous processing model. And sometimes, like, one tank wasn't getting completely drained. And it was blocking something else that was upstream. So I had an interactive subroutine so that when I could see that happen, I could just kind of step in and clear it out while I was debugging. So that kind of helped with that process.
And yeah, and that was conditions. On a real project.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it helped
wasn't
me
just
see
the classroom.
No. Yes, under which the lockup would occur. And you can kind of run it longer if you don't have to worry about the model locking up.
Okay. All right. We have, I think, 4 more slides. We'll slide through this pretty quickly. You can either activate or execute. I got it in quotes because the word execute is not in ProModel's vocabulary, but activate is. Activated subroutines run in the background. Another way to think of it is in parallel with entities being processed through the processing routing. Another way to say that is logic in an activated subroutine is done independently of the entity that caused it to start. Therefore, after an activated subroutine is activated, the entity that started it carries on regardless of what happened in the activated sub. And examples are maybe periodically examine inventory and do reorder for entities. But I'm going to come back to that in just a second. Or for animation, you know, you want to do a script to choreograph a model presentation. Now, here's a real tricky aspect, perhaps. An activated subroutine can order, the statement order, O-R-D-E-R, entities to locations, but not if there are any attributes involved. And I thought I had that specified particularly. Somewhere in here, I think it says no entities, no attributes. And the model will tell you very quickly You cannot put an entity attribute in an activated subroutine. So you can order, however, the children entities from an activated subroutine all have attribute values of zero. There is no parent to child transfer of attribute values. Whereas an executed subroutine, where you just name the subroutine, that every logic in that subroutine must fully be completed before the entity can continue on. Therefore, the entity is delayed, the executed subroutine, until the subroutine fully finishes, which is usually what we want to do anyway. But if it gets into an infinite loop, you've got a lockup in your system. And here's a good example. Here's technique I use in a lot of my models. I activate in initialization, I activate a clock calendar subroutine, which among other things creates the value of a variable, which is based on cal year, cal month, etc. Right here. And then I can, anywhere in my logic, I can say wait until that variable, which is updated every minute, wait until that variable is greater than or equal to some attribute start time. That's a convenient way, not the only way, but it's a convenient way to, say, for example, have trucks scheduled into the truck docks particular times of days. You know, you wait until the year, month, date, hour, day, minute of hour is now of interest, and then let that thing proceed. You have the truck wait out in the parking lot until that time comes. We also have execution of subroutines for a lot of different ways. I would encourage you to go to our CAFE, Solutions CAFE, into the webinar section. And there's one particular webinar. In fact, it'll sound familiar to you because I did that last year and a half ago. But it's a very good webinar that, in my opinion, that describes how to create a comma separated value log file of everything that happens in your model. And therefore you can take that database created by the CSV and take it into Excel or Access, pivot tables, filtering, whatever. And this is what it looks like. And then the result is a log file. Whoops. Oh, I just just loaded something. Let's use Excel. And this is what the log file looks like. So here's a description of everything that happened in the model. And that's conveniently done in a subroutine. If I stop the model and look at my processing, notice that every process executes the log file on every entry and executes the log file on every every process record. Great way to use a subroutine. And here's another example. I can turn on or off asking what are the owned resources. Sometimes I don't know whether I've got one or two, and I want to know whether the fork truck is number one or number two. Therefore, I can run a subroutine, and it'll display that for me to allow me to best choose the owned resource number to use for the movement. Okay, there it is. And we are right at 1 hour. I thought it'd be less, but it's right at 1 hour. So open for questions, comments, anybody? Austin, are you opening their mics, by the way? Austin, are you there?
Yep, opening up the mics right now.
Okay, so if anybody wants to voice a question, you can feel free to do that right now. Meanwhile, just recognize that Austin and others are in our support technical support team. You can email them at support@promodel. You can also call them at 888-PROMODEL. Recognize that L is a superfluous because that's eight letters. And then also I encourage you to look at the webinars in the Solutions Cap. So sounds like we have no current questions. Jennifer, anything wrapping up of interest that you want to say?
No, I just wanted to mention too, another place, a good place to use subroutines is if you need to do some complex calculations in a field. So for example, location capacity, you can put a subroutine that uses a return statement there instead of just putting a number or a formula. So you can actually go in and look up something from an array and have it return a value. That's something I use quite a bit.
Yeah, like the capacity can be a integer subroutine.
Right.
Right. I hadn't shown that here, but yeah, that, excellent. Okay, we're wrapped up now. I appreciate everybody joining. If you have further questions or comments, feel free to contact customer support. You can also call me directly. So thank you for joining and have a good day.
Yeah, thanks everyone.
Austin, you want to halt the recording?